Madam President, honorable members of this court, learned colleagues, good afternoon. My name is Jeremiah Lau, and these are my co-counsel, Mr. Benjamin Wong and Ms. Lisa Tan. Today we appear as Team Alvarez, acting on behalf of the defendants in this reference to the Court of Justice. I will be speaking on the first issue for 8 minutes, Mr. Wong will be speaking on the second issue for 8 minutes, and Ms. Tan will be speaking on the third and the fourth issues for 9 minutes. With your permission, we will reserve 5 minutes for surrebuttals. Thank you. Madam President, the claimants in their submissions have tried to paint this case as a very straightforward application of the objective test. However, the crux of our submissions is that, well, things are more complicated than that. The defendants are the four principal wind turbine manufacturers in the country known as Ruritania. Under immense pressure from the Ruritanian government, our clients took steps to restore public confidence in the environmental friendliness of wind turbines following a public confidence crisis and protests on the street, as well as to promote innovation in the wind turbine industry. This took the form of an agreement to restrict the selling, or rather the output, of certain less efficient and smaller wind turbines on the market. Despite these two special circumstances that I've highlighted, the first being the legitimate objective of innovation as well as environmental friendliness, and second, immense pressure from the government, the Ruritanian Competition Authority has still seen fit to insist that this is an object limb restriction. The question before this court and your Honourable Justices today is whether these special circumstances are indeed relevant when you are construing the object limb test. If I could quickly summarise my submissions. Thank you. Firstly, the modern test for a restriction of competition by object is clearly a contextual one. I'll explain more on what this means later on in my main submissions. And secondly, it is certainly relevant that the agreement was concluded pursuant to immense government pressure from the Ruritanian government, which vitiated the consent of my clients, as they did not enter into the agreement of their own free will. If I may proceed to my first submission. Thank you. The question on the bench's mind, and indeed everyone's mind, must be, what is this contextual approach that we are talking about? The contextual approach that I refer to can be found in the recent Carte Bancaire case of this court. In that case, the court said that you must undertake a contextual analysis of the restriction in question, taking into account firstly the objectives, as well as the legal and economic matrix on which the agreement rests. What this means precisely is that you cannot just look at the plain wording of the restriction in question. You have to see what the objective of the agreement is, what it sets out to do. Indeed, object is simply a shortening of the word objective. Therefore, this court should consider all the objectives of the agreement, which includes the objective of innovation as well as environmental friendliness. The next question in the bench's mind might be, what evidence does the defendant have to support this conclusion that there is indeed such an objective of innovation as well as environmental friendliness? In Carte Bancaire, the court provided guidance on how we are to approach this issue. The Court of Justice said that, firstly, you have to have reference to the nature of the market in question in order to see whether the defendant's submissions on the objectives are believable. Well, the wind turbine industry in Ruritania is part of the clean energy industry in Europe as a whole. And the clean energy industry is very high technology and innovation driven. Any modifications or progress in the form and function of wind turbines is indeed driven by very high tech advancements. Therefore, we submit that it is entirely natural and reasonable for this court to accept that one objective of the agreement was to promote innovation, as innovation is the very lifeblood of this industry.
Counselor, isn't that exactly where competition law should be most skeptical? That is, where you have a highly dynamic market, where you have a number of independent sources of inventive activity, which, say the literature, say so much of the case law, are indispensable to technological dynamism, you're arguing that reducing those centers of independent inventive activity is a benefit. How is that?
Thank you for the question, Your Lordship. I would agree with Your Lordship to the extent that innovation is going to happen anyway in the industry, because there are, as you said, every one of the four wind turbine manufacturers are indeed a center of innovation, and this is so crucial to the industry that in any case they will engage in innovation. However, The important point that I want to bring across here is that we are under a very tight timeline. The rotating government put immense pressure on us to produce results right now. They said that if you don't do something to restore public confidence in the wind turbine industry, we'll threaten to legislate, and they didn't exactly say what they legislate. It was a vague and ominous threat. So in order to restore public confidence in the wind turbine industry, what we needed to do was to reduce this thing called wind amplitude modulation, which the public was complaining was affecting birds as well as the noise that was transmitted to their homes. Therefore, to achieve such a drastic increase in technology and innovation in such a small amount of time, we submit that the only way that we could have done this was to come together to form this agreement with the objective of increasing innovation.
Why don't you form an R&D joint venture where you master resources behind the development of a more environmentally friendly technology? Why are you obliged to take specific technologies or approaches off the market?
Thank you for your question, Your Lordship. The possibility of a horizontal cooperation agreement with the objective of increasing research and development was certainly one thing that our clients considered. However, that would again take much longer time than we had. We needed to produce results immediately, and therefore we needed more funds.
Tell me why that takes much longer.
Well, because a horizontal research agreement does not create the funds in and of itself to conduct such research. According to the agreed facts, the defendants submitted in their reference that the reason why we had to enact these output restrictions, or rather one of the reasons why, was to increase the profitability of the operations in order to channel these increased profits directly and immediately into innovation. And that's what we needed to do.
So you're telling me that in any setting in which there is pressure to improve performance with respect to environmental protection, health, safety, any number of other dimensions of performance, that firms will be able to escape object-related condemnation by saying, we are withdrawing products from the market or otherwise constraining the range of our production activity in order to enable us to earn higher profits, which we promise will be channeled into the desirable activity. This becomes a broad general exemption from object condemnation.
Your Lordship, if I could express my position on this issue, and if I could have more time to address the other submission as well.
Please.
Thank you. I would say that what we are arguing for today is not such a broad exemption. In fact, we are setting a high threshold that this court should be comfortable with accepting. Only in extreme circumstances, such as the circumstances that we face today, where number one, you have an industry that's driven by extremely high technology, and the technology needs to happen almost overnight, the improvement in the technology. And secondly, all this pressure was coming from an external source, the rotating government. Only in these circumstances should the court accept that indeed raising profits through an output restriction is a necessary evil, as it were.
Can you distinguish the Biggs case, because there was heavy governmental pressure on the beef producers, or the government or involvement in their decision to reduce capacity in the market?
Thank you for the question, Your Ladyship. The beef industry case, we can distinguish it on several grounds. Firstly, on the ground of principle, the anti-competitive conduct in the beef industry was too egregious. They were not channeling their... what happened was they certain beef producers took payments in order to exit the industry so that there were fewer beef producers and they could earn more money. What the objective of this agreement was to save the existing beef producers by increasing their profits. You can see that the beef industry in Ireland in that case was a sunset industry. It was plagued by financing problems, cash flow problems. Therefore, it can be characterized as a failing industry attempting to resuscitate itself through output restrictions and increased prices. However, this case is very different because what we are trying to do, the wind turbine industry in Britannia is, cash flow solvent. It is doing well. Clean energy is improving in Europe as a form of energy production and is a booming industry. What the profits are going into here is innovation and not to save a dying industry, which is the exact kind of anti-free market conduct that competition law is so against.
So you seem to be saying that we should be more concerned about a cartel that manages the decline of an industry than a cartel in a highly dynamic industry, which we should be less concerned about.
That is exactly my point, Your Lordship. I would say that because there is...
Sorry, again. This court should be more concerned by a cartel in a declining industry than a cartel in a dynamic one. Is that your point?
I would, if I could reframe your question, Your Lordship, I would say that the existence of a cartel to sustain and to drag from the grave a sunset dying industry is inapplicable to competition law, because there is inherently in competition law a belief that the free market has the ability to generate efficiency. If the beef industry in Ireland could not sustain itself through normal operations, it should be allowed to die off.
Yes, I have. You seem to submit that you were under the pressure of the government to conclude that agreement, but on the other hand, it seems that you took benefits of this agreement. So you were happy with this agreement. So is that a little bit contradictory to say that you were under the pressure, but on the other hand, you took benefits of this agreement? That's my first remark. And the second one is a question: to what extent should we take into consideration the intention of the undertakings when signing, concluding this agreement?
If I could address your questions in sequence, Your Lordship. The first question pertains to how we reconcile the government pressure with the fact that certain benefits accrue to the industry. Well, to reconcile that, I would say that absent government pressure, we would never have entered into this agreement, because we are businessmen and not altruists. We are not out to save the environment, neither are we out to spur innovation independently of any government pressure. What happened was that there was a public confidence in crisis which required these things to happen immediately. And therefore, due to the government's pressure on us to act immediately, we had to do these things. And secondly, with regard to your second question on the intention of the parties and how it is relevant, I would say that there are two kinds of intention that are well known to both common law and civil law lawyers: subjective intention and objective intention. With regard to the first kind, the subjective mens rea or the mental element of the parties, I would note that in Carte Bancaire, this court said that it is not in itself sufficient a factor to turn the case either way, but there is nothing preventing the Court of Justice from taking it into account. So that's the starting point for the subjective intention. And with regard to the objective intention of the parties, we will submit that that is our entire case, that viewed objectively, the object of this agreement was indeed not only to restrict output, but also to promote innovation as well as environmental friendliness. So in that sense, the objective intention is relevant.
Is any threat by a senior elected official or cabinet minister to obtain legislation sufficient to create the level of coercion that provides protection of the kind you're asking for here?
I would say that I would agree with Your Lordship in that any threat is not sufficient. However, in this case, there's more than just a threat. In the months preceding this reference, the Ruritanian government has firstly enacted zoning regulations that lead to drastic reduction in demand for wind turbines in any case. So you can only place wind turbines in very rural or farmland kind of areas. That was the first wave of pressure that mounted on our defendants. Secondly, there was indeed the threat to legislate. And I would say that this threat is particularly bad in this case, because it was vague and ominous. The government did not say exactly when they would carry out the threat, which means they could carry it out at any time. Neither did they specify in any detail at all what kind of legislation they would enact. Therefore, our clients reasonably assume the worst. For example, if there were a threat to do something minor to the industry and this was spelled out clearly, I would say that that would not fulfill the state coercion defense.
Would you agree with me that adopting legislation is more difficult than threatening to adopt legislation?
I would agree that, yes, in principle, because there's a consultation process, I would agree with that.
And isn't one reason to require the enactment of the law to enable you and your clients to be able to turn to the government and say it's not enough simply to threaten? That is, we will not deviate from the mandate of the competition provisions of the treaty until you genuinely compel us by reference to a text. Doesn't that give you more protection to resist? Or to put it another way, if you relax that requirement, does it not encourage more public officials to make demands, perhaps public officials who are not fond of the competition law?
Would it allow them to make more demands? I would submit that, in fact, it would allow them to make less demands, because the setting the bar at irresistible pressure rather than black letter law is, it would send a signal to government officials that their actions in threatening, coercing, nudging defendants to agree or acquiesce to their demands is entirely inapplicable to competition law, and these agreements would be void because they would be, or rather the responsibility would be transferred from the defendants to government. If you set the threshold at black letter law, it would lead to governments trying to game the system by doing everything possible short of reaching black letter law. So they could coerce, they could threaten. As long as they don't actually enact a statute in parliament, they're not responsible.
I'm not sure that I see that it doesn't encourage them to do more of the threatening. That is, if they want to override the mechanism. That is, isn't the rationale for the formal act, the demand for it, the recognition that that is hard to do? And as a consequence, you want to make the public officials take the ultimate step rather than simply threatening to do that. Would you agree with me there is a danger in relaxing that requirement?
I would agree with you that there is a slight danger in relaxing the requirement, in that defendants might try to raise spurious claims, like this official threatened me on this occasion, and so on and so forth. However, I would say that the threshold must be at irresistible pressure rather than black letter law, precisely because competition law values substance over form, and in many cases, governments can act in many ways that fall short of black letter law that in fact vitiate the consent of parties to the agreement. Therefore, they can coerce parties to their will using all the resources of state without actually enacting law. Therefore, I would say that going back to first principles, if we only want to hold parties responsible for things that they have actually consented to do, the irresistible pressure threshold, even taking into cognizance the danger that parties might raise spurious defences, is in principle the correct threshold to hold.
Isn't there an alternative way of looking at this issue, which is to say that to make it easier for government to reach private agreements with industry of the kind that we have here, subverts the legislative process. There is a due process for legislation in which all interested parties have an opportunity to comment. I think you referred yourself to the consultation. Shouldn't we hold that process as one that should be followed, and we should not permit private agreements that would detract from the integrity of that process?
We entirely agree with that point. Thank you, Lordship. The idea of a public consultation is indeed fair, and it is it gels well with the principle of fair administration that's found in the European Union. However, we can see that in this case, the Rotinian government did not conduct the consultation. Neither did they, in fact, give us time to respond. They gave us a very vague, imminent, and ominous threat. Therefore, we accept that, in principle, it would be good that if governments abided by the fair consultation process and not reach private agreements with defendants. However, in this case, the coercion was so imminent that any possibility of a consultation was simply not there.
Your argument is that we should
allow your private agreement, we should give it a more favourable treatment than it would otherwise have received, precisely because of that government threat, which
yes.
seems to weaken the position of not only you and your successors, but the process as a whole.
I would say that we should allow our private agreement in this case, because the idea is that the consultation process was not followed through with. If in a counterfactual it was followed through with, then the private agreement is surely inimical to competition law and should be punished. Therefore, the rule I will submit should be flexible, and the irresistible pressure standard is indeed flexible, in that it does not require actual black letter law, but it looks at the circumstances. Was the pressure indeed irresistible in the circumstances? And in this circumstance, it was, because there was no consultation, no process for us to air our grievances to government. It was simply a threat, and that's it. If I may be of no further assistance to this court, I'll pass the time to my co-counsel, Benjamin. Thank you.